The, and who was, one of the very first astronaut tourists, but most importantly had the vision to fund the XPRIZE, which was subsequently, eventually won by Bert Rutan in Spaceship One, resulting in the creation of Virgin Galactic. And in a way, was the opening shot in the era that began in early 2000 period of private space enterprise. Before Spaceship One, you know, the people who thought they were going to do something in space with private money were dreamers who never really came together. That was the first thing, and I think that gave enormous encouragement to further developments such as SpaceX, Blue Origin, and other such things that are emerging all over the place now. So, without further ado, Anousheh Ansari.
Bravo.
Mm-hmm. Really raise the energy, and it's always wonderful to speak to a group that, you know, I don't have to know why space is important, because you're all here, because you understand it. So I was born a long, long time ago in a country far, far away. and I grew up, you know, with my head in the skies. I loved the night skies. I would look up to the stars and imagine these other worlds, these other civilizations. Imagine another world looking down at planet Earth and thinking about the same things. And I always wondered what's out there. And this curiosity about, you know, learning what's out there, understanding it and relating to it, and wanting to go up there was what got me interested in man and science at a very young age, and sort of built the rest of my life. And I looked up there and I kept wishing for aliens to come and abduct me. So I had to come with an alternative way. But I was born to a very modest family in Iran. I grew up in Iran until I was 16 years old. And as I was growing up and imagining going to space, I told everyone that I'm going to go to space. I even image and I gave it to my mom, and I went around the house showing to everyone. I said, this is how I'm going to go to space. And as you can imagine, they probably looked at me and they talked to themselves, you know, this young girl, you know, she's going to grow up, she's going to forget. Oh, it's such a nice picture. And of course, I'm one of those people that, you know, when I say something, I really put everything behind it and I get it done. So I had to show them that I can do it and do it exactly as I do it. My mom's surprised when she saw this picture after my launch and remembered the drawing that I had given her a long, long time ago. But that's how humans, you know, make changes in our world and build different things. But change comes sometimes without you doing anything about it. So I was growing up in Iran. The first big change that happened to me is when I was about 12 years old, the revolution happened, and everything around me changed. Like, you know, I was growing up in a country that was pretty liberal, and, you know, everything was fine, and I never imagined my world would be turned upside down. And then here I was 12 years old, and, you know, there were people shouting outside my window, you know, burning cars, burning buildings. I'm very, very angry, and I've never seen that anger before in my life. And I didn't know where it came from, and it scared me. And then before I could even deal with that, then the war broke out really long, and there were bombings, and there were shelters, and all different things. And you know, I just didn't understand why, you know, this was happening around me. The world around me was falling apart. So I always could take refuge in the night sky. So even as the whole world around me was falling apart, I could go out there and look up at the night sky. And remember that I'm part of a world that's much bigger than what I see around me. And I can belong to that bigger world, and I could take refuge in my life. And that's where I found peace, and I was able to survive whatever was happening around me. And that has become part of my life. Even today, that's what I do. So imagination is this powerful, powerful gift have as human beings, and sometimes we forget about that. As children, we use it a lot, and as adults, we don't use it as often. But imagination is what has built our civilization, has allowed us to imagine things that don't exist and, you know, create them. Imagine places that you know, we've never been, or create those places. So it's something that's very powerful, and it's like a spark of an idea that starts perhaps because we saw something someplace, or maybe we saw something on TV. I'm so excited about the new Star Trek. You know, and wonderful book that you would read. I love science fiction books. And then you start imagining yourself in those characters and those positions, and then you start making it. And this was my way of, you know, making my fantasy come true at one of our all-hands meeting with my management team. And I made the entire management team dress up in Star Wars costumes. But, you know, as I was growing up and watching Star Trek, I thought, you know, as I become an adult, I can go and apply to Starfleet Academy and, you know, science officer on board Starship Enterprise and travel there, all the different galaxies, and I would, you know, be able to make my dream come true. And when I came to the U.S., that didn't happen. I looked for Starfleet Academy in the yellow pages. I couldn't find it. So then I had to do something myself. I had to find the opportunity somehow, some way to make, you know, that dream, not only for myself, but for millions of others, a lot of you sitting here, to make that dream come true and at least take the first step toward that. And that's why, you know, with my family, we became capital sponsors of the Ansari X Prize to just fuel this sort of innovation around building something that can take humans to space, because the government space agencies had not fulfilled that promise for a long, long time. And thankfully, the $10 million prize became very successful. We had 26 teams that competed from 7 countries, and they all, actually, a lot of them have continued to develop what they were developing and contributed to this nascent, you know, private space industry, the new space industry that has been created that's now estimated at hundreds of billions of dollars. So to me, that was exciting, and then to the team at XPRIZE. So since then, you know, the four of us meeting in the basement of San Luis Science Center, things have changed a lot. We have gathered a lot of who's who of, you know, different types of tech industry, space industry, and have created a way of using competition to solve major challenges in the world. But space is still at heart of everyone on the board. So we have Google Lunar X Prize, which is our active prize in space, and continue to look for other ways of using competition to develop new technologies that benefits our industry. But when I talk about space, you know, you can look at it, how the world of technology, as it's changing, is making it possible for most everyone to participate in one way or another to make this future that involves space coming true. So if we look at how to get to space, and a lot of you guys have been, you know, talking about some of these technologies all day today. But, you know, we talk about Virgin Galactic, some orbital flights, and then orbital flights. And that sort of started with the Ansari X Prize and continuing to flourish as a lot of these policies have changed since we started working on it at X Prize. And then SpaceX and what Elon is doing, which is amazing, creating orbital capability with his reusable rockets, and very soon, hopefully, we'll see actually passengers taken to the International Space Station and beyond that. Blue Origin, another tech entrepreneur who put his passion and his interest and his money behind creating capabilities to fly us again on suborbital and orbital capabilities. And I had a chance to visit one of the mock-ups, and it's going to be an amazing experience with those large windows to be able to see on the planet from up there. Beyond that, there's, of course, a lot of advancement in the way we travel once we're up there with the plasma engines and the successful test of that. But once we're there, we want to stay there, especially for people in this room thinking about building a colony on Mars and staying on Mars. There are also technologies like 3D printing that is going to make a huge difference in what we need to take and how we can survive out there, not having to really deliver everything out there. Of course, the replicator, you know, we have a replicator there so we can get our Earth very hot up there. But some recent, interesting, actually building larger structures up there on Mars, and the NASA $2.5 million prize for a design of a 3D printed habitat on Mars, which this is the winning design, of course. 3D printing is even now being used on designing the next version of the spacesuit and parts of that. But once we're there, we also may need additional capabilities, so augmentation and through a lot of robotics capabilities that are developing and becoming more affordable would allow us to do things in space that we were not perhaps able to do that, and then to allow our bodies to stay healthy and then active while we are in space. So when I also talk about space, a lot of people say, well, we're spending, hundreds of millions of dollars, billions of dollars on space. What about here? We have so many problems here. And of course, I don't need to tell you why that is important, because, when we're up there, we're actually doing a lot of things that always benefits our planet. Through the, advancement of exponential technologies and Moore's Law, imagery, computing, a lot of technologies have become so affordable that now we can, and they have been miniaturized, that we can build these really powerful CubeSats and NanoSats and be able to, this is a picture of fuel that we launched from the International Space Station. We're able to learn amazing stuff from, about our own planet. And now people, students in universities, in even high schools are building satellites and are able to launch these satellites at a very low cost and learn a lot about our environment. We also now have actually a company and probably more of us coming around thinking about how do we use the resources in space, so planetary resources, thinking about mining asteroids. And the Moon Express wants to be able to bring things back from the moon. And there are a lot of these other companies that are being popping up around the world, looking at how do we make the space economy work better. One of the areas that I'm particularly interested that's making some advancement is solar-powered satellites, and how can we harness the energy of the sun and bring it back there. And then everyone talks about cloud computing, and if we can find a way to actually put the cloud, computers above the cloud where it's cold, where there's plenty of solar power, and not pollute our environment as much as we are doing with the data centers we're building around the world. But more than anything else, I think for me, as a young girl growing up in Iran, space brought me hope. Space was where I went and I found refuge. And I know for millions of people out there, like this young girl who's a Syrian refugee, the refugee camp, dreaming of becoming an astronaut. Space can, help you take yourself out of all the craziness that's going around you and allow you to imagine a different world and imagine a peaceful world. And for me, one of the biggest gifts that I had from my trip to the International Space Station was the gift of knowing and having this perspective of our planet, which is a planet that's a home for all of us, all 7 billion people living on it. And that once we can see that, once we can experience that, we can come together and make that vision that we see from space come through here on Earth. And that's, I think, one of the most important things. So with that, I hope that we can all together imagine a different future for our planet, for our world, for our young people, and make that come true. So I'm going to share with you a little bit of a video from my trip to International Space Station, hoping that it will take you on a new journey to space. So can you play the video, please?
Being under the stars and watching the stars twinkle, it was something that I wanted to experience for myself.
So these are all the mystery
of the unknown out there always have been drawing me to space. the universe is calling me.
Three other crew members on board the space station when they arrived.
Bombers arrived from Germany, probably with a lot of from Russia and the Jesuits. For the first time, I will see the Earth as a really beautiful, glowing blue glow in the background of the universe.
About being in space is that because you're floating, you don't have a concept of the floor, ceiling, or walls. You basically use the entire space. And if you imagine this room being floating, you can move around or down. So in the next part, you can imagine this is you flying to the space station, and you can see all around you their equipment, their experiments. You're using the entire space. The station is much bigger now. That was launched, and it's a Russian segment, and it's used mostly for storage.